Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. God, I thank you for your word over me, that the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I pray that that joy will be the joy over all of us this evening, that you become our strength. And so, God, we ask, God, that you would take residence, and more than that, precedence and lordship in all our lives, because we're in a series called Go Beyond. And to do that, we need you. Nothing else. We need you. And so I pray above and beyond hearing my voice, ultimately, every single one of us, including myself, will hear yours. And so may your word become alive in us. May your spirit be like fire in us. And then may our faith grow from us and out of us to engage in the many things you have for us outside there for us. In Jesus' name we pray. And we all say together, amen, amen. Are you guys ready? You guys ready? I'm excited. The series called Go Beyond. I mean, it's just listening to it just stirs up. It's got to stir up something of expectation. And what better person to talk about, or we continue to talk about, than the man Abram. His name got changed to Abraham, but right now what we're talking about is Abram. And then I'm going to read scripture, Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. And that's what we're going to land on. That's going to be our foundation. That's what we're going off of. And so we won't do a whole lot of jumping around, but we're going to sit right there. And we're going to try to hear the Lord to see, how does this apply to me personally? As the church, we're in this all together. We're in this, all the campuses, all the services, all the pastors, all the servants, all the volunteers, we're in this. But personally, I'm asking the Lord, individually for us, as we go beyond as a church, we're all part of the church. The Bible says that we are the church. What does this mean for us? What does it mean as we leave this place? How does it involve our home? How does it involve our marriage? How does it involve our campus, our school, if you're a teacher, if you're a student? How does this involve your workplace? And so that's my prayer. But let's go ahead and read Genesis 15, starting from verse 1, and we're going to end at verse 6. It says this, "After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eleazar of Damascus? And Abram said, You have given me no children, so a servant in my house will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him, This man will not be your heir, but a son who is of your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and said, Look up at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Now, before even like doing a study on this and getting into this, this is known as the Abrahamic covenant. Okay, and I had to look at the word covenant. And so I went online and looked at the definition, and what is this word covenant? And the word that the definition that the online dictionary gives us is the word contract or agreement. And I thought about that, and I scratched my head for a bit, and I was like, a contract or agreement. And I asked myself the question, so why didn't the writer of Genesis just put in the word contract and not covenant, right? Why do we use this word covenant? Because if it's contract, then I understand and it makes sense. But then I looked into a little bit more, meditated on that, and I realized that God's covenant versus a contract are two different things. Two totally different things. When I think about a contract, I think that it's between two parties or two people who are in somewhat equal footing, where they come to an agreement and they create a contract, and this agreement, if it's upheld, everybody's happy. But if it's not upheld for either party or for both parties, then they'll face the consequence, or there's some kind of a penalty to this. And I never forget, if you've been a victim of this or you've fallen into the trap of credit cards, when I was a sophomore in college, I went to a school in the mainland, and in the main hub, in the lobby area, there's always an event. There's always stuff going on. There's a job fair. There's performances all the time, acoustics, rock bands, and everything. And all the time, sprinkled throughout this lobby are these tables of people trying to get you to sign up for your credit card. And I said no a bunch of times, but I never forget, my sophomore year was really the beginning of the end, because I said yes for the first time. And they convince you, right? They're like, yeah, you can start your credit, and you get like a free beach ball, and you get a free glasses. And I'm a city sophomore, student, and I'm broke. So I'm like, money? You know what I mean? So I have no idea. And then what happens? And then you sign this contract. you're obligated to pay what you owe, which is what you spent, and more. I mean, what kind of crazy thought is that? You know, you think about a house, right? You sign a contract. You're agreeing to this house, and it's not beyond your means, or so you hope. And then you sign this contract to say that I'm come to an agreement that I will pay on time, and that I'll, you know, if you have association fees, you got to make sure that, you know, everything's clean around the house. If not, you get warnings. Anybody ever got warnings before? We did. And so you sign this contract. Or cars, the same thing. Business deals between businesses or businessmen. There's this contract. But I come to understand that God doesn't work like a business deal. He's not like a business-to-business contract. Why? Because the difference is a covenant deals with relationship. There's an intimacy that happens there. So God doesn't work on business contracts. And for me, that rattled me. That exploded every idea I ever had, that I'm signing a contract as a Christian. And if I don't uphold this deal of being good and holy and righteous, then all of a sudden there's a penalty and a consequence. Sure, there are to our sins. But then that's not the relationship that God wants, this business deal. Covenant, as we're going to see in Genesis chapter 15, Abram is this relationship, is this love relationship. It's this intimacy that happens between God and Abram, Abram and God and us, us and God. And so there's a very different understanding. First of all, there's no equal footing between us and God. God is all powerful. He's all knowing. In fact, I think about it, it's so absurd to keep God accountable. You know what I mean? Why? Because he's God. He's good. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, then when we relate it to church and to our Christian faith, I mean, how silly would it be that if you were to receive Jesus Christ tonight, if you're not a Christian, don't worry, we're not going to do this. This is a joke. Or, you know, you receive Jesus Christ and you raise your hand and we had a table outside, and at the table was a contract that you had to sign to fulfill certain things that Christians are supposed to do. Matthew chapter 28, it's the Great Commission, right? It's therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded, and I will be with you to the end of the age. Imagine if that was the contract, and you stood at the table and, oh, I received Christ. Okay, now sign the contract that you're going to go and make disciples. I mean, could you imagine how silly that would be if God was really like that? Don't worry, we're not like that. But there are other religions that are. How silly would that be? You know how empty that line would be? And the reason why I wouldn't go to that table, and the reason why is because either one of two things. I wouldn't do it, or I just can't do it. And so that line and that table would be completely empty. God doesn't work like it's a business deal. He is personal. He is loving, and he is intimate. And so when God makes a deal with Abram, it has more to do with who God is, has more to do with who he is and what he's going to do, and has nothing to do with who Abram, although he is a father of faith. And you read that in Hebrews chapter 11. Even though his name is mentioned so many times in that Hebrews chapter 11, known as the father of faith, even though it's not about Abram, it's not about what Abram does. Although God uses Abram, it has everything to do with who God is and what God wants to do through Abram. And may I say this as well? For us this evening, has everything to do with who God is, and it has everything to do with what God wants to do through your life. Has everything to do with who God is. God's name bigger than Grace Bible Church Pearlside. Has everything to do with what God wants to do through this church. Are we all on the same page now? And so with this interaction, so Abram, he encounters the Lord, and he's in this conversation. There's this covenant that's happening, which is full of love and grace, but also encouragement and boldness. And out of this conversation, Abram knows that in order to achieve and to do and to accomplish everything that God wants him to do, he needs to trust in God. And so in each step, trust in the Lord and his security and protection for you and for me. Let's go ahead and review Genesis 15:1. It says, after this. Now, what is this after this? A chapter before this, Abram defeats these kings and their armies, and then the king of Sodom has said, thank you so much. He's super stoked. And he's like, thank you so much for defeating the armies and the kings, and here's some wealth, and here's some land, and here's some flock. And Abram, so in his wisdom, says, no, I refuse to receive any of that. And so here's after that. So here's after this. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Here's what God says. The Lord says, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield and your very great reward. Do not be afraid. I mean, wouldn't you be afraid if you just killed off thousands of armies and kings just in case? I mean, I'd be afraid because of retaliation or maybe revenge. And so it was so perfect for God to say, do not be afraid. And then he says, I am your shield. I mean, if there's anybody who understands the need for a shield in battle and in war, would be Abram. He just came from a battle. He just came from a war. So God knew exactly the words he needed to hear. Do not be afraid when you move forward in taking my command out in faith. Do not be afraid, and I will be your shield. In other words, I will be your security, and I will be your protection. You are all that I need. And then how awesome is this? And I will be your very great reward. Just not too long ago, Abram denies the receiving and being a recipient of rewards from a worldly and earthly king. But here comes God and he says, no, I'm glad you denied that because I'm much more than that. I will be not just your reward, but your very great reward. Any English teachers? How bad is that grammar? Right? Sorry, I'm not dissing on God, but your very great reward. I think he's trying to emphasize something, that I am all that you need. And I pause to say this. Only if we knew, really knew, that every day in our lives, that the Lord is all that we need, then we'll truly understand that he is the greatest protection. Only if we knew every day, and even as I say this, I stand here convicted. Only if I knew that every day the Lord is all that I need, he is my greatest security. Only if I knew that every day we need the Lord, then we would really know that he is our very greatest reward. And I think tonight, I think he wants to remind us of that. That today, like I love what Pastor Farris said, Easter was just not even the end, it's the beginning. The beginning of great things. If you're a Christian here tonight, you know what I'm saying. That there's great things for us to accomplish for his kingdom. Again, let me say this, not our personal gain, but for his advancing his kingdom. There's great things for us. And if you're not a believer, you're not a Christian, there are so many things that our loving and gracious Heavenly Father has in store for you, but he's not going to pressure you or force you into relationship with him. Why? It's not a business deal. It's not a business deal. You know, I never really got to get through all the Godfathers. Anybody a big fan of Godfathers, right? The horse in the bed. You guys remember? No? Am I the only gangsta in this place? Like it's just, you know, it's like, you know, he's not the Don. You know what I mean? He's not going to, I'm going to give you a deal you can't refuse. You know what I mean? He's not. And if you're not going to refuse it. And if you try to, you don't want to. You know what I mean? God's not like the Don. He's gracious. And he's loving. He's a gentleman. He draws us in till we encounter him. And the only answer we could ever have is, yes, Lord. And you're here tonight if you're not a Christian. You've been drawn by his great love and his grace and his mercy. But tonight would be the night you say, yes, Lord. And when you say yes, the promises and the purpose he has for life is immeasurable. Why? Because he is all that you need. Jeremiah 29, 11, 14 says this. We know this scripture. I want to point out a few things real quick before we move on. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your hearts, and I will be found by you. This scripture has everything to do with him. We're not seeking after purpose, not prosperity, and all these worldly things. Those are byproducts. If it's his will, the main thing is when we look for him, we're not looking for stuff. When we look for him, the guarantee is we'll find him because he is all that we need. He is all that Abram needed. Regardless of what the challenge was, regardless what the purpose of the plan was, if it was a few people or it was an inheritance that was more numerous than the stars in the sky or the dust and the sand on the seashore, it didn't matter because all Abram knew was that all I needed was God. And let me tell you, let that be the point this evening, is that when we leave this place, let's just have some faith, a faith that our God is all that we need. We all have different things going on in our life that involves furthering and advancing his kingdom. We all have different trials in our life. If we can leave here believing, as we're about to read, believing that the Lord is all that we need, then watch him move as we obey. Genesis 12, just to remind us in what God promised to Abram. The Lord has said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. One more chapter over in Genesis 13, here's what God tells Abram and reminds him again. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. I wonder why God needed to remind Abram. I wonder why God needs to remind us, because maybe we're here this evening. We're like, oh, we're talking about Abraham again. I've heard him probably five times this year, starting when I was 5 years old in Bible study. I don't know. We need to be reminded over and over again. Why? Because it's focusing on God. We must focus on God and focus on his promises and not on the problem. Focusing on God, focusing on his promises and not on the problem. Now, what was Abram's problem? He had a problem. Starting from verse 2, it says, and Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eleazar of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. So he had no children. God, if you're going to promise me children and generations after me, as numerous as stars in the sky and as many as dust and sand on the seashore, how is that going to happen? I have no children. All I have is a servant. And how are you going to do that? But here's what I love, and I think we can learn something from this, is how Abram starts. He doesn't just jump out with this problem and say, Lord, how are you going to do it? How are you going to make it happen? I have no children. What does he say? He says, oh, sovereign Lord. We don't catch that sometimes. Sometimes we come before the Lord and we just say, God, how are you going to do it? How are you going to get me out of my mess? How are you going to make it work? How are you going to do this? What's the solution? But I love the humility. And then we're going to get, he says, oh, sovereign Lord. Lord in the meaning are these words, Adonai and Jehovah. Is these holy and sacred and adoring and reverent titles. And he starts off, but before he gets into a complaint, because he complains, he says, oh, sovereign Lord. Does anybody ever start your prayer with the title, oh, sovereign Lord, Adonai, Jehovah? Anybody? No, not me either. I don't do that. But for some reason, he started that way, and he says, oh, sovereign Lord. And you know what happens right there? He makes sure that God is in his rightful place. He understands right away, before I complain and before I voice my concern, I want to make sure that God is in his rightful place. Lord, King, Jehovah, Adonai. He makes sure. It reminds me of a scripture, and I think it's in Luke chapter 14 or Luke chapter 4, 6, maybe one of those. And it's Jesus who says this. Jesus says, why do you say, Lord, Lord, and you do not do what I command? Why do you say, Lord, Lord, and do not do what I command? You know what Jesus is addressing? Those who say, Lord, but never obey him. When Abram comes before the Lord before his complaint and he says, oh, sovereign Lord, he says it with such reverence and puts God in his rightful place. It's almost like it's to acknowledge who God is, but it's to fix his heart. And sometimes we need to just say, oh, sovereign Lord, and in saying, Lord, you know, it's just not a, can I just say, it's not a confession. You just in personally for myself too, many times we confess, but we have no conviction. Oh, Lord, you know, we hear it a lot of times, even in culture and society. Oh, Lord, you know what I mean? I say that too. My kids do something. Oh, Lord. I walk into the living room and all the toys are all, oh, Lord. In the moment, I'm not using the title of Lord to put God in his rightful place. I'm just saying it. And that happens a lot in society. And it could have been really easy for Abram to kind of come in that way. But how does he come in? He comes with reverence. And he puts God in his rightful place. And Abram says, you are my great reward, but what are you going to give me? I love that. He's like, so how are you going to make this happen? And what are you going to give me? And it's almost like he reminds God, okay, God, did you forget I have no son? Did you forget I'm 90 years old and my wife is 80? Did you forget that all I have is a servant? And even if you were to give me all this stuff, because I have no heir, my servant's going to get all of it? Do you see what's going on? And then here's what the Lord says, right, as we continue with this verse. The word of the Lord came to him. He says, this man, Eleazar, this man will not be your heir, but a son who is of your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and says, look at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said, so shall your offspring be. Now, there is never going to be an Abram ever again, okay? Because how many of you guys want to be like Abram? No, probably not none of us. There's never going to be Abram. But how does this relate to you? Are there things in your life where you've come toward to God and just complained and didn't come before him in a humble manner with humility and say, oh, sovereign Lord, how are you going to do this? How are you going to deliver me from this? How are you going to use me in my workplace? I mean, I hear from this church about grace group and reaching out, but how are you going to do this? How are you going to make this happen? You know, I had a moment where that happened, and it was almost 3 years ago. And I never forget, you know, when there's talks about starting the Kaneohe campus, and we prayed about it, and we sought the Lord, and I had those same questions. And I knew that the Lord was calling my wife, Chanel, and I, and my family to spearhead this and gather the folks together and begin this campus. And I knew this is what God called me to do, but I had those questions. Okay, God, I know this is what you want to do. It's going to take a lot of faith to do this. But the questions I had is, when do we start this? I mean, how is this going to look like? I mean, are people actually going to come? I mean, you know, and you go through all these questions. And if you know what, I'm pretty sure many of us know what I'm talking about. When there's something that God's called you to do that almost seems impossible, and if it doesn't seem impossible, then maybe you need to pray and seek the Lord a little bit more. But if it doesn't seem impossible, if it looks impossible, then it causes us to be desperate for after God. It causes us to seek the Lord more than ever before. And then I realized in those moments, although those questions were good, that the focus should be on God and what he says and his purpose and his promises and less on the problems. And I realized that as we started walking this endeavor out of planning a campus out in Kaneohe, every single walk, it always seems like there's a problem. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Like, you begin to walk for God, begin to journey in faith, and all of a sudden, all these problems start coming up. That was another opportunity for me to say, okay, am I going to focus on the problem, or am I going to focus on God and his promise? Every single step like that. You know, there's a guy on our campus, his name is Richard Santos, and he's an awesome man of God. He's gone through, in a series of many years, he's gone through two divorces, and his last divorce is about over 2 years ago. But in that moment, he came to know Jesus Christ, and in that, you know, he was seeking for counsel and for mentorship and discipleship, and he's walking through this healing. But while walking through the healing of what was going on with the separation and divorce, here's one of the questions he had in the midst of all that. He says, God, how do you want to use me? Because for some reason, in his crazy mind, and we all have this question, he was thinking that if I just served God, then serving God and serving others is also part of my healing process. I mean, how crazy is that? He had every right, and he could even feel entitled to just stay at home and just bear it, bear down, and just kind of, you know, grin and bear it and just kind of stay there. But for some reason, God was calling him to serve God by serving others in his workplace. And so what did he do? He trusted that was God's plan for life, and then he would show up at his park bench at Iroquois Point. You guys ever went to Iroquois Point? If you live at Ava Beach, don't be offended, but I never knew that it could be that beautiful out there. It's beautiful at Iroquois Point. The man-made beach, even though it's man-made, you know what I mean? Because out in the windward side, it's not man-made. It's real. No, I'm just kidding. It's not that I even go to the beach, you know, so what am I talking about? Iroquois Point, it's beautiful out there, and he would sit at this bench for 6 years, and he would pray. What he was praying, God, use me. And you know, in the meantime, he's not just preaching the gospel, he's living the gospel. I mean, guys are looking at his life and he's like, man, how are you even like, how is there joy while you're at work when you're going through a divorce? I mean, they couldn't put things together. And it reminds me of a scripture in the Bible where I think it's in Corinthians, it says something along the lines of living your life in such a way where people start asking questions. If people aren't asking questions about our lives, then the question is, are we actually following Christ? People were asking questions about his life. They were thinking, how is this guy walking through this? But he's like, there's joy, and he's talking about Jesus. And for 6 years, he would pray at this park bench, and all of a sudden, one guy came over, and he started sharing the word. And then two guys, and then five guys, and then eight guys. And 8 years, 6 years, guys started showing up. In the last 2 years, he's had about 15 to 16 guys come through. I have a picture. I visited them on Friday. There's a picture of these guys. I mean, like, Moki guys. I mean, just like, when I showed up, my Mok turned on. I goes, oh, bro, what's up? Like, bro, hey, bro. Like, and like, they even gave me a fluorescent shirt, and I felt like I didn't deserve it because my hands are so soft. Like, but like, I was so honored to get this shirt, and I was so cool. And I sat down with them on Fridays, and I said, tell me why you guys came. Like, tell me what God's doing. And the stories in like 40 minutes was so powerful. But guess where it all started? With Richard praying at this park bench, God, I'm going through hell right now, but there's something you've called me to do. You want me to reach my coworkers. And these are the same coworkers that would drive by and walk by the park bench and start teasing him and dissing him. They'll be like, oh, read your Bible again. Oh, good luck, all by yourself. Like, they'll just start talking trash. But it was those same guys that they knew they could go to Richard in their time, in the greatest time of need. It all started with God. How do you want to use me? Look, Abram was at this place where he's like, okay, God, you want to use me? Okay, you want me? That's going to happen in my life? Okay, God, I need you, and I know for a fact that you are all that I need. Saturday night, a live service. Saturday night, like, God has called you for great things that goes beyond this service. The reason why I come every Saturday is because I get to worship, but every time I'm worshiping over there, there's something in me that says, this is a service that can break out. This is God stirring something in here. And so to even imagine that this service is just a one-stop shop and it's kind of a service is a lie. There is something in this place that I believe that God is stirring in all of our hearts. Even if it's a fraction of us, good enough, everyone else will catch up. But there's something bigger than this. There's something that God wants to do, and I'm talking specifically with this Saturday night service. I'm excited because God's going to do something amazing in this service and outside of this service for the people who would say, God, you are all that I need, and if it means that I need to pray at a park bench for 6 years to see you move and fulfill your promise, then so be it. How does it pertain to you? Is it a park bench? Is it a chair somewhere in your office building? Is it a new table in your cafeteria? What does it mean for you? I believe Saturday Night Live service, God wants to do something, and all God's looking for is for someone like Abram to say, Lord, you're all that I need, and I want to obey. As we come to a close. So we believe and hold fast to God who will fulfill his promises according to his will. And here's where we're going to end. Genesis 15, 6. This is huge. It says, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He believed in the Lord, and it was counted as righteous. He believed in the Lord, and it was counted as righteous. He believed in the Lord, and it was counted as righteous. Do you believe in the Lord? Here's one observation. It doesn't say that his prayer counted him as righteous. It didn't say his works counted him as righteous. It didn't say that his duties or his speaking or his reaching counted as righteous. It was his believing. Because it has everything to do with God, had nothing to do with Abram. And for the same with us, if you want to be used by God to go above and beyond to where, from where you're at right now, look at this. Believe. Believe that God is all you need. Believe that the Lord is all that you need. And God will look at that because of Jesus Christ and what he has done on the cross. He looks at his son, and he will look and he will say, Did they trust in my son? If they trusted in my son, they're a child of God. And because they're a child of God, then they are made righteous, not because of their works, not because of what they've done, because of what my son has done. And he look upon us, for those that have trusted in Jesus Christ, and he says, you are righteous because you believe. And the Bible says that we're a child of God. You know what that means, that we're a child of God? It means that God has got us. He's in control. He's taking care of us. The Bible says if God is for us, then who can be against us? But that promise is only for Christians. And so if you're not a Christian here this evening, think about your life. I can't promise that for you, because the Bible is so clear that for those who put their trust and faith in Jesus, in Romans it says, for those who confess with their mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and they believe in their heart that he was risen from the grave, that's the Easter story. It says, then you are saved, and that means you're a child of God, and because you're a child of God, you're made righteous, and because you're made righteous, then God's going to carry you, he's going to empower you, he's going to blow on you, so when you leave this building, he's prepared things for you, that when you begin to engage it, you're going to step back and say, wow, that's you, God. How did you even do that? You know, when I talk to Richard, he's like, how did this happen? And always points him back to Jesus. Abram believed in God and was credited to him as righteous. Maybe you're here this evening, you're like, man, I don't want to fail. You know what I mean? I don't want to try, and it doesn't work. Here's the thing I've discovered about God. Failure is not a problem if we're giving God our best. What is failure? For giving God our best. Because here's what will happen. If you give God your best, he'll take it, and he'll make it good enough. You're trying your best, there's no failure, because we're giving him the best, and he'll take everything, all our attempts and all our efforts, because he's the one that receives the glory, and he's the one that's using us. He's the one that we're doing it for. He will take it, and he'll make it more than good enough, where we can step back and say, God, you're good. Abraham had moments. Abraham was not perfect. He failed many times, but there are many times he stepped back, and he says, wow, God, you're good. When's the last time you had a moment where you stepped back and say, wow, God, you are good? If you haven't had one in a while, then here's the challenge for you, to go beyond. It's time to go beyond. It's time to go beyond. Again, I'm not talking about personal gain. I'm not talking about let's get promotion for my business. Let me get an advancement. I'm not talking about personal gain. I'm talking about how are we involved in furthering and advancing God's kingdom. All that other stuff will be taken care of. Why? God is the God who takes care of us, because we're a child of God. It's time to go beyond. It's time to go beyond.